With Steven Universe Future coming to a close, I wanted to take a look at Steven Universe itself and talk about what made it such an amazing show. And frankly, it is nearly perfect. It has issues like any show does, but it gets about as close to perfect as any show can. While Future and the movie are both part of Steven Universe as a whole, I will not be talking about them in this review. Instead, I will be focusing entirely on the original series. The original series, after all, is the story Rebecca Sugar and the Crooniverse set out to tell, with the movie and epilogue being follow-up material created after the fact. When the series first got renewed through season 5, Rebecca was informed that she likely wouldn't be getting any more episodes after that, and while that didn't turn out to be the case, she did write the series with the intention to stop at that point, making it one complete story, and it stands entirely on its own 2 feet without the movie or the epilogue series. And at the end of the day, that is Steven Universe's biggest strength, that it is one complete story. TV has more potential than any other format of visual storytelling, in my opinion, but it does have a lot of flaws as well. A good story requires a beginning, a middle, and an end, and those are a lot easier to pace in books, movies, or even in a single season of a TV series. Most TV is renewed by the year, so it's hard for the writers to know where the middle and the ending of their story should take place. Steven Universe wrote its first season as a first act to the story, introducing us to the world, its characters, and bringing us an inciting incident at the end that brought the true plot to the forefront, the conflict with Homeworld. With the renewal of seasons 2 through 5, Rebecca Sugar was able to plan out her middle and end to each take place over 2 seasons. Other shows often just keep building new and improvised plot lines each season, with them racing towards an intended endgame as soon as they are greenlit for a final arc, assuming that they had an endgame in mind at all. While this doesn't entirely remove the issue of pacing, as you still have to deepen the story as you go along, one episode at a time, it did give the crew a single idea to constantly build towards and branch off of, and the actual endgame is yet another one of the show's greatest strengths. TV and other similar formats are made up of 2 key things, plot and story. Plot is the physical journey that the characters go on. For instance, in Steven Universe, the plot is about a young boy who wants to be a superhero like the 3 women who take care of him. Story, on the other hand, is the emotional journey, which in Steven Universe is about a young boy trying to define his relationship with his mother, and by extension, his relationship with himself. A good TV series needs to have both of these elements, and a perfect series would tie these two together as closely as possible, and the show does a genius job of that, particularly when it comes to the ending of the series. In the beginning, Steven looks up to the Crystal Gems, seeing them as superheroes, but they in turn looked up to Steven's mother, who was at the time known as Rose Quartz. Since he is her son, the only way Steven believes he will be able to get the Crystal Gems to accept him is if he is able to walk in his mother's shoes. The first season establishes this by showing Steven slowly becoming more and more involved in the Gems' missions. Along the way, the show does a great many things. It establishes the beginnings of these characters for their eventual arcs to be explored. It expands upon the lore of the world so that future plot points are immediately understood by the audience. And it builds up how seemingly perfect his mother is to everyone around Steven, and how he struggles to understand how he could possibly live up to her. The story side of this is meant to resemble a real-life family who experienced an important death before or around the time of a young child's birth. No one wants to speak ill of the dead, much less to that particular person's child. We also tend to hide or forget the flaws of someone who passed away, remembering the good times in their absence because we miss them. The result of this is that the child doesn't realize that this person had any flaws at all. Very little of Rose Quartz's personality changed from the beginning to the end of the series, but by seeing the context of these moments in their entirety, we're able to see that she isn't really confident, but rather arrogant. She isn't wise, but rather she is naive. Suddenly, things that made her seem perfect were recontextualized to make her seem more flawed than anyone around her. Season 1, or the beginning of the story, if you will, ends with Jasper coming to Earth with Lapis and Peridot and taking what remains of the Crystal Gems as prisoners back to Homeworld. Steven is asked to leave with his father, but through his story, he realizes that the only reason the Crystal Gems survived the previous war was because of his mother's shield. Stephen realizes that in order to become an adult, to become a crystal gem, and to live up to his mother's legacy, he needs to be involved with this battle, even if the others disagree with them, and protect them the way his mother did. He does do this, and ultimately, it does work out for them as they manage to destroy the ship and crash land back on Earth. This transitions them into Act 2, The Middle, which takes place over Season 2 and 3. The plot of this act is mostly just dealing with all the inciting incidents from before. Jasper, Peridot, and Lapis all represent threats to Earth because if they can make it off planet, there's the very real chance they will send more homeworld forces after them. Lapis and Jasper have also fused as Malachite, and Peridot also comes with the threat of the cluster, both of which are resolved by the beginning of Season 3, leaving the only major plot thread left hanging to be Jasper roaming the Earth. While this plot is really interesting, the story is actually even more so. With Act 1 being about Stephen wanting to be like his mother and then deciding to follow in her footsteps, Act 2 deals with him realizing that this may have been a mistake, that his mother may not have been the saint he thought she was. This starts with him realizing that her relationship with those around her came with more issues than he'd previously thought, namely with Pearl. In Sworn to the Sword, Stephen realizes that Pearl felt like it was her responsibility to protect Rose Quartz no matter what, that she was entirely expendable in comparison to her. While it's noted that Rose didn't encourage this, that it has to do with Pearl's own issues and who she is, it shed light on how his mother seemingly did nothing to balance out this relationship, indulging Pearl just enough to maintain this dynamic instead of helping to fix it or even returning some of the same sentiment to her. This reaches its climax at the end of the season, with Mr. Gregg, when Stephen realizes that this same dynamic wasn't just on the battlefield, but in their love lives. It was pretty clear to us that Pearl had romantic feelings for Rose Quartz, but in Mr. Gregg, it was all but confirmed for us. All while reminding us that while Rose did indulge Pearl's affections, she also had affections for human men, particularly Gregg, and would often do things that hurt Pearl in order to pursue those relationships. While Rose should not be held responsible for Pearl's feelings, a large part of her character is meant to cast light on the gray area of morality. The world is not black and white, the answer isn't yes and no. While Pearl had autonomy to leave her, Rose could have prevented a lot of the pain she felt by not indulging Pearl just enough to benefit herself in this relationship. No one wants to lose a friend, but sometimes you have to make that sacrifice to stop that friend from hurting themselves because of you. Stephen continues to learn more about the imperfect nature of his mother in Season 3, particularly through the character Bismuth, and the revelation that Rose Quartz supposedly shattered Homeworld's ruler, Pink Diamond. Bismuth wanted to shatter the Homeworld elites, and Stephen thought that mindset was too dangerous, that it would make them the very thing they are trying to fight against. It wasn't as simple as killing being bad, but rather about it being hypocritical. He was surprised to learn his mother held the same stance, hence why she bubbled Bismuth, but the fact that she would do this and never tell the other gems was a mystery to Stephen, one that made him question if she didn't do it out of some sort of malice. Especially when you consider that Rose Quartz didn't unbubble Bismuth after she did the thing that Bismuth was going to do herself. When he learns that his mother supposedly shattered Pink Diamond, it recontextualizes it and makes it seem like she's even worse of a person, a hypocrite. He understands that his mother meant well, that she did what she felt she had to as the war reached its end, but he also acknowledges that she wasn't the perfect hero he thought she was. And Act 2, The Middle, ends with him realizing that it's okay for him to not be just like his mother, that as Bismuth told him, maybe he could be better than her in some ways. So the beginning of the story was him wanting to be like his mother and seemingly achieving his goal. The middle of the story was him realizing that his mother wasn't perfect and maybe he shouldn't aspire to be just like her. So Act 3, the ending, pushes the story further by making him believe that it may be too late, that he is now doomed to be exactly like his mother, particularly her flaws. Stephen has been a seemingly forgiving person up to this point. While he isn't happy about every action committed by a gem, he is at least understanding of the emotional issues that were behind it. With his mother, however, all he has is the context of the stories, and essentially none of the emotion involved with them. Everything good seems to be done for a perfect moral reason, and if anything goes wrong, it comes off as her making a selfish mistake, because all he has to go off of is the end result. season 4 reaches its climax in the episode I Am My Mom, where the story and the plot for the entire series begin to tie together in the most beautiful way. Steven is, of course, half Jim, and at this point, there is the question of how much influence Jim has over him as a person. For all he knows, he is literally just his mother in a human shell, and that thought scares him. He made a naive mistake in season 2 of telling the names of Beach City citizens to Peridot, who used those names in her report, a report that was used by the Diamonds to collect more humans for the human zoo. In the end, Steven blames himself for it, and he isn't entirely wrong. While this doesn't make him a bad person, it was a mistake to be that blindly trusting. Since he has been holding his mother accountable for her actions without context, however, he believes he needs to do the same to himself. At this point, he embraces the idea that he is in fact his mother, just a shell carrying out her will, and therefore he should be the one who goes to trial for her crimes, which also protects his friends by getting the Diamonds to stop hunting them for the human zoo. Steven escapes in the end, of course, and while on trial, he realizes something about the story of his mother shattering Pink Diamond doesn't make sense. And at the end of the season, he discovers the truth, that his mother was in fact Pink Diamond all along, and she simply faked her own death with the help of Pearl. While this seems like a good thing to most people, as it absolves her of the guilt of being an actual shatterer, it is in many ways worse. Ending the life of an evil dictator, while it has its issues, is overall considered a noble thing. Pink Diamond, on the other hand, wasn't noble enough to even stand up to her own family, to be upfront about her rebelling against them. Instead, she found a way to stop the invasion that hurt her family in the worst way possible, and left behind millions of broken gems that were forced to fuse together, with millions more being changed into a horrifying monster to roam the world. Pink Diamond, on the other hand, got to live the rest of her life on a paradise of a planet with her best friends. She existed seemingly guilt-free, enjoying that life immensely, and if she did feel any guilt, it seemed possible that she created Steven in order to have an excuse to escape it. Now, more than ever, his mother was something Steven absolutely would not want to be. His mistakes made him question his autonomy, as they were similar to his mother's, but now he is also experiencing her actual memories, as if they're all in his brain, as if he is just her repressing these feelings. In the series finale, the plot and the story collide in a way that I have never seen matched by any other show. White Diamond's tyranny stems from the belief that the world works in a particular way, that gems are meant to be this one thing, and they can never be anything else, including Pink Diamond. When she rips out Steven's gem, it's to prove the truth to herself and everyone else, to reveal Pink Diamond was the one controlling Steven the entire time. Instead, we see her reform as a pink version of Steven, but even more interestingly, this Steven seems to be entirely emotionless. Steven himself, on the other hand, seems to be functioning entirely fine in terms of his mind and emotions. Instead, it is only his physical strength that has vanished. This proves one thing to him, and to everyone else in the room, that he was in fact his own person with his own thoughts and ideas and emotions, and that the only thing his mother provided him is what any mother provides to a child, life. It isn't until Pink Steven touches the real Steven that he begins to show any emotion at all, and only matching his as they fuse back together again. The conclusion to the plot was overthrowing the Diamonds, guaranteeing the protection of Earth and his friends, but the conclusion to the story was that Steven isn't his mother, that none of us are just an extension of our parents, that we are truly our own people, not doomed to make the same mistakes of our parents. The plot wasn't merely a vehicle or a shell to explore this theme. In many shows, movies, or other storytelling formats, we may see the emotional journey exist next to the plotline, but it's largely unrelated, something the characters happen to work through along the way. But in Steven Universe, the two are contingent upon one another. You cannot have one without the other. Every single aspect of the show becomes meaningful as a result. And it's not just the way they approach this theme that makes it a nearly perfect show, but also the depth of the theme itself. Storytelling tends to come with a moral at the end of it, but it can often feel patronizing, insincere, or at the very least shallow, particularly when it comes to children's media. Steven Universe became so popular with adults, on the other hand, because of how seriously they treat their audience. The big theme about Steven's relationship with himself is echoed throughout the rest of the show as well, all of which focus on different kinds of relationships and an issue they face in relation to the context of the physical plot. For instance, there is the character Amethyst. She is presented as being on the lazy side, doing things on the fly and focusing more on having a good time. As the series progresses, we learn that Amethyst is a bit different, that she came out wrong compared to the way she was programmed, with a large part of that being that she is shorter and seemingly far less powerful than other Amethysts and Quartz soldiers as a whole. At the end of Season 3, she becomes involved in a battle with Jasper, who seems to be her opposite. She came out entirely perfect and naturally has every advantage. After being defeated by Jasper, Amethyst decides she wants to turn the tables on her, something that seems rooted in the need to feel powerful. If she can defeat Jasper, it would help her convince herself that the first battle was a fluke, that she wasn't born wrong. Most kids' shows would use this as an excuse to talk about brains over bronze, having Amethyst concoct some plan to defeat Jasper, probably where her sheer strength is her downfall, but Steven Universe is no such show. Instead, the show chooses to embrace the fact that some people are going to be better overall, and that this doesn't invalidate you as a person. It doesn't make your existence lesser. In the end, the only way to defeat Jasper is not in a one-on-one battle that would prove Amethyst is the best, but by fusing with Steven, symbolizing that the only way to overcome those who are naturally and obviously more powerful than yourself is to work together, to form healthy and beautiful relationships where you take care of each other. A lesson that is true to the world we live in, one that is impactful both spiritually and realistically. Steven Universe reaches its greatest depths during the Sardonyx arc of Season 2, one that finds a meaningful way to address the topics of consent, not just in a way that makes it safe for kids, but one that recontextualizes it for mature audiences as well. Fusion, like we discussed in Amethyst arc, is representative of a relationship. Garnet, for instance, being fused nearly all the time, is meant to represent a long-term romantic relationship. To her, the sanctity of their fusion or relationship is the most important thing. Early in the arc, we are introduced to the concept of forced fusions, where gems are shattered and then have pieces of them forced together with other gems to create terrifying monstrosities. The chief issue to Garnet here is that this was done against their will. They didn't have any choice in this. Later, Garnet fuses with Pearl in order to destroy a tower that is broadcasting signals from Peridot. This seems to be a positive experience, but when they find the tower has been rebuilt, Garnet and Pearl fuse again to take it down. It is eventually revealed that Pearl is the one actually rebuilding the tower, and that she is doing it specifically so that she and Garnet have reasons to fuse, which in the context of the metaphor is giving them an excuse to maintain a relationship. When Garnet learns the truth about this, she of course feels betrayed. The experiences were positive for her too, but context changes everything. It was no longer about two people working together for the goal of stopping the antagonist, but rather it was just a relationship for the sake of the relationship. And maybe Garnet would have liked that as well, but she was never given the proper information to make that choice. While the two do eventually make amends, it was a powerful story about consent. And not just in relationships that are romantic, or even relationships that are... well, you get the idea. When Garnet learns the truth about Rose Quartz, the person she looked up to and who in many ways was responsible for her relationship, suddenly that relationship falls apart. Now, the last 5,000 years as Garnet had been a positive experience, it was all predicated on a series of lies. The truth may not have changed things, but in the end, they could have built their relationship to be exactly what it was now if they knew the truth about the person who was putting them together. But that was not the choice they had, and now all they can do is question what would have happened if they had been free to figure out who they were without any lies influencing their relationship. These explorations are so meaningful, and they don't even cover everything addressed in the show. But as I said before, the show is only nearly perfect, as it does have its flaws, the most obvious of which is pacing. Early on, this was used to its advantage, allowing them to slowly transition from one formula to another in order to have the story focus on new things without it feeling too jarring. At least until Season 4. Season 2 and 3 were jam-packed with all sorts of amazing things, from character histories to villains and climactic battles. But by the end of the season, so much was resolved that it didn't leave much for Season 4 and 5. All we had to go on was the idea that the Diamonds might come back to check on the cluster themselves at some point, and not much else. On top of that, what little threat they did have hanging over us was reserved for event episodes only, as opposed to weaving in and out of the story from one episode to another, like back in seasons 2 or 3. So most episodes that didn't deal directly with the overarching plot suddenly fell very flat. The plot and the story began to separate heavily, with attempts of emotional character moments feeling disconnected from the actual plot of the gems dealing with homeworld being unrelated. The emotional aspects felt shallow as a result, and it seemed like the show had already used up all of its good material in season 3, with nothing left but what it had saved for the eventual ending of the series, with the crooniverse being too afraid to add anything new in this new middle section for fear that it could affect the overarching plot that they had been building. These issues pale in comparison, however, to some of the flaws with the finale, which is often considered the most important part of any story, regardless of whether it was really about the journey or not. The finale delivered amazingly in some ways, but the great climax was sandwiched between two very awkward moments that a lot of fans took issue with. First, before the climax, was what could have been an intense moment of Steven trying to save his friends. Him fusing with them despite being poofed was a great idea, showcasing just how close they had become. But in the writer's attempt to showcase the new fusion's personalities, there were moments that felt truly awkward and childish. While Sunstone is a fun character who parodies the PSA mascots of the 90s and early 2000s, showcasing this in the final episode of a 5-seasons-long build to the plot made people feel like the show wasn't taking itself seriously. The same issue happened again as soon as Steven fused with his pink self, where he ends up telling a bad joke that makes White Diamond blush, and this seemingly being her final push to accepting that Steven is who he says he is. While it is meant to highlight that White Diamond also wasn't perfect and that she was simply suppressing the parts of her she claimed didn't exist, it took a serious and essentially deadly moment and once again made it seem childish and like the intensity of this genocidal dictator suddenly didn't matter. In the end, the power of the scene before it, as well as how climactic it was, helps to make up for it. It wasn't just a cool scene or a cool moment, but an answer to the questions we had been asking since the beginning of the show, both the physical and the thematic. Everything from the writing, to the storyboarding, to the sound design, to even the animation were so well executed that it's easy to forgive those moments from before and after. Because at the end of the day, you can't really expect a show to be 100% perfect. You can't even expect one episode to be entirely perfect. But one moment, one scene, being the perfect way to end the entirety of the series, is enough to make those lesser moments, those hard-to-sit-through arcs and endless-seeming filler episodes, suddenly feel like a necessary part of an almost perfect journey. At least, that's what Steven Universe was for me. Thanks for watching.